Have you ever wondered what happened to my sweet child? Chances are they entered middle school. Best-selling author Kevin Leman helps families navigate through this fantastic and, yes, awkward journey. On today's 700 Club Interactive.
Good morning and welcome to 700 Club Interactive. And today we're going to a place that would give Dante nightmares. It's a place of tears, jealousy, and torment. That's right, we are going to middle school.
Inside the classrooms and along the halls, you'll find no shortage of people who describe the middle school years as turbulent, which is no surprise, really, when the only people in sight are moody adolescents. So one teacher in New York made it her mission to give her students a lesson that they won't find in textbooks, a lesson in unconditional love.
When I first moved to New York City, I thought I knew why I was coming here. It was gonna be an adventure. I had my own agenda. I had no idea how much I would fall in love with the kids of the city and how much they would teach me about myself and change my life. I treasure my morning commutes on the subway. It's my time. Sometimes it's my only time with God. In those moments, I know his love for me, and I know that that's gonna carry on throughout my day, and I know it's gonna help me to do my job well. The Bronx is one of the toughest neighborhoods in the country. 75% of the people live below the poverty line, and where there's poverty, of course, there's gonna be violence and sadness and strife, ugliness. Right in the middle of the Bronx is Middle School 223, where I'm a reading and writing teacher to sixth graders. It's where I spend my days every day. A lot of our kids at our school go home to shelters. They go home to homes where they're in charge. They see people get shot in front of their apartment door. Life has not been easy for them or kind to them. Morning. Good morning. Hey guys. Thanks for coming in quietly. Many of my students haven't been loved well. They've been abandoned. They've been promised things that have never come. They've been promised relationships with their fathers or mothers that have never happened. And so they're just worn. They're weathered, and they don't trust love. On the first day of school, the first thing that I tell them is, I've been thinking about you all summer. Like, I love you already. You may not believe this, but you can't earn my love. You could make straight A's all year and have perfect behavior all year, or you can get detention 3 times a week and I'm gonna love you the same. And then I spend all year trying to prove it. So I want you to think back to Monday. We chose that one personal narrative that we're gonna publish and celebrate and put out there to the world. Who am I as a person? What do I really want people to know about who I am? Well, it wasn't until recently that I realized that God had been preparing me for this job, for these kids at the school right now. I grew up in Georgia, mostly at my grandmother's house, because my mom and dad were divorced. And then when my dad got married, I felt like I wasn't good enough. He wanted me to be perfect. I just wasn't good enough anymore. But I know I don't need other people to say I'm okay anymore. I did that my whole life, and I think I'm finally done. So maybe now I can just be Lindsay, and if I make mistakes, then oh well. I'm not only as good as what I do. Growing up, and especially now, even as an adult, I still long for that love and acceptance, and God has shown that to me and given that to me so that I can go and give these kids the same love and acceptance that they have always wanted too. Over time, I really do believe this classroom becomes a safe haven for them, a place place where they feel accepted and they know they're going to be safe and it's comfortable. I think God loves these kids so much, more than I could ever hope to love them. But I think He wants them to rest and to be happy. I think He wants to heal their hearts. Every day they walk out of my classroom, and at the end of the year, they walk out of my classroom forever. It's so hard. It's hard not knowing what lies ahead for them or what type of choices they'll make, and I just have to rest. I've done everything I could do. I've loved them the best that I can. And then my hope is that they'll figure out that God loves them so much more than I ever could.
Well, Lindsay, we thank you so much for the remarkable influence you are in your students' lives and reminding us the real way to reach a child's heart through love like that. And it's such a wonderful illustration, of course, of our Heavenly Father, how no matter how successful we are in the eyes of the world or what our failures are, God loves us the same. He loves us the same. And we celebrate teachers who are making such a difference in the lives of children around this country. And by the way, we are very thankful to our friends at Daydocs Films for that story. And you can watch more of their inspirational videos by going to their website at daydocs.org. Terry?
Well, if you've ever seen a volcano erupt out of nowhere, you've seen what it's like to raise a middle schooler. So what's a parent to do? Kevin Leman shares his answers, and that's next. Ah, the middle school years, filled with fun, games, raging hormones. And if you've ever looked at your school-age kid and wondered, what happened to you? Kevin Leman says there's a really good reason why. Take a look.
Starting middle school is like entering a different planet, both for your child and for you, says internationally known psychologist and parenting expert, Dr. Kevin Leman. He says it's a time when peer pressure, technology, and hormones wreak havoc in a child's life and damage their relationship with mom and dad. But Dr. Leman says the changes and challenges of middle school don't have to leave your family in chaos. In his book, Planet Middle School, Dr. Leman shows you how to help your child survive and thrive in the often turbulent years of middle school.
Well, joining us for more is Kevin Leman, and we welcome you back to 700 Club Interactive.
Thank you, Terry.
Talk about these middle school years you write about in Planet Middle School. There are a lot of changes for kids at this point in time.
It's a perfect storm. You do have the hormones raging. You've got parents who are blown away with what's happened to my little girl or guy. Used to cuddle up and give me a kiss, and now I get these stares like, whatever.
What do you want?
And they cry. To quote my wife, Mrs. Uppington, I call her Mrs. Uppington because she's the classy one of the two of us. She says the 11-year-old female is the worst creature, the strangest creature walking the planet.
Ooh,
and she's probably right. So these kids are tenuous, they're up and down, it's bullying.
Confronted with a lot.
Everything. What your kid wants to be in middle school, and I want people to really listen to what I'm about to tell you, is anybody but themselves.
Ooh, that's intense and sad.
Yeah, it is. So they're pulled by a peer group that says, smoke this, drink this, shoot this,
and how about
cut yourself.
Television, Kevin? I mean, the things that we see on television for kids that age are kids that are mean to each other in school, smarting off to each other, the teachers appear to be dumb. I mean, you've got to monitor some of that input or you're going to live with it.
You do. If your kid is going to be in the world of technology, okay, you better know all the passwords. You better have a lot of safeguards in there because these kids will text like a woodpecker that's got a bad case of ADHD. High-speed internet.
That's true.
And these kids will say the most nastiest things, particularly young women.
Yeah.
Okay. And we've seen all the accounts of kids who've taken their life because of the prosecution and the bullying that goes on through cyberspace. So this is a time when parents need to stop and evaluate and say, wait a minute, is this a home or a hotel? If it's going to be a home, then there ought to be some things in the home that give kids comfort. And again, you and I don't hang out with people who make us feel uncomfortable.
No.
So if you want your kid to feel comfortable, you can't be hammering them for everything under the sun.
Yeah. So talk a little bit about what a home that isn't like that might look like so that we can walk down those paths of suggestion.
Well, the home that I would like to create is a home where kids work, mm-hmm. where they give back to the family, where they have ownership. Why can't your 11, 12, 13-year-old daughter pay all the bills in your family online for you? What a wonderful experience for her to understand how much it costs to run a family, how much a car payment is, what rent is, what a mortgage payment's like. And I call it reality discipline. In other words, give the kids a piece of the action so kids understand that they're a part of this family. Mm-hmm. No one member of the family is more important than what? The family. And the more you can bring that into the kids' everyday existence, the more they're going to feel comfort and receive nutrients, psychological nutrients, from who? From mom and dad, their brothers and sisters.
Talk a little bit about, you mentioned it, but talk a little bit about technology, because it's both friend and foe. I mean, you want your child to be proficient at it because the world is moving that way, but how much, when, how do you gauge that?
Well, give your kid a, if you're concerned about communication, and we live in a fast-paced world, there's no two ways about it, give them a dumb phone. Yeah. Kids do not need access to the internet in third, fourth, fifth grades. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, parents today are knocking themselves out trying to make sure their kid is happy at every turn. An unhappy child, and I can quote myself, this comes from the book, Have a New Kid by Friday. An unhappy child is a healthy child. And there's times your son or daughter has to be unhappy. So parents, don't knock yourself out trying to make sure everything's okay for little Buford and his little brother Fletcher. There's times when they just have to be disappointed and saddened. Why? Because they disobeyed you, they talk back to you. So what I'm saying is, parent, put yourself in authority over your kids, and here's the hard part, Terry, without being an authoritarian.
Yes, wow.
So say to your kids, honey, I'm interested in what you think about this. Mm-hmm. Don't ask kids questions. Husbands hate questions, kids hate questions. Don't ask questions.
But engage them in conversation.
Engage them. Tell me more about that. That's interesting.
Speaking of conversation, and that's interesting, let's talk about the talk that usually happens or should happen in middle school.
If there's an interstate near you, get on it and start talking to your kid about sex. Dads talk to daughters. Yes, I know your husband doesn't know a tampon from a fine cigar, but mom can have that discussion, okay? But mommies can tell sons how women want to be treated. Mm-hmm. And daddies can share with women how men view women. Mm-hmm. And so it's that cross-sexual relationship. And there's something very good about looking out that window when you're having this conversation with your kid. And your kid, by the way, who's 9 years old, check that out, nine, is looking out the rear or the side window saying, I cannot believe this conversation. But you go on the freeway because there's no stoplights, no red lights, they cannot leave the vehicle.
And you get to finish the talk.
It's not easy. Yeah. Who woke up this morning and said, I'd love to talk to my kid about sex today?
Not me.
And in the church, we've done a terrible job. Yeah. Nobody talks about sex in the church. Well, if we say God is the creator of sex, then why are we afraid to talk about sex?
Exactly.
I love sex. Look at me. I'm near death. And we slow down to four or five times a week. I want to be clear about this. You do slow down.
Talk a little bit about academics, because parents are so fearful that if their child, you know, shows any sign of lack of performance in one subject or another, they're on them like white on rice because they're afraid they're not going to get into college. They're not going to finish their schooling. I mean, how do you handle
that? Terry, now you're hitting where it hurts, because I was not a great student. I graduated fourth and bottom of my class in high school. I remember my daughter brought home her math assignment, and I looked at it and I said, Shazam, when they start using letters. I mean, it was news to me. But today, it is moving at warp speed. And parents, read to your kids when they're really young. Let them see the wonder of books.
Yes.
Let your kids read to you.
Yeah.
When grades come home, this is really important. In Planet Middle School, I talk about the fact you need to respond and not react.
Uh-huh.
Your kid brings home all A's. What do most parents say? Oh, all A's. I am so proud of you. I'm calling Grandma and Aunt Martha right now, and here's $20. Mm-hmm. Well, please don't tell me there's something wrong with that, Leman. Yeah, there's plenty wrong with it. That's just praise, empty praise. God deserves our praise. Your 11-year-old doesn't, okay? Yeah. Encouragement. Now, here's encouragement versus praise. Wow, five A's. I'll bet that makes you feel really good inside. Hey, honey, congratulations. It looks like all that work you did really paid off.
That's right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the takeaway for the kid is mom and dad recognized how hard I worked to get those grades. But they're not mom and dad's grades. They're my grades.
They're your grades. Exactly.
There's a key difference. You will never find, well, I shouldn't say never. There's very few books. I've written 52 of them. From a psychological nature that will explain to you the difference between praise and encouragement.
Yeah.
And Planet Middle School does a pretty good job of that.
Quickly, I just want to mention you're opening Leman Academy.
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty exciting. That's out in Arizona, but you're planning to go nationwide.
We are. It's a classical school, which means kids take Spanish in kindergarten and Latin in the third grade, logic in the sixth grade. High expectations. And you'll love this. No excuses.
Yeah.
From the child, from parents or grandparent.
Yes.
We're not into excuses. Excuses make the weak weaker, and people are lined up trying to get their kid in Leman Academy of Excellence, so we're going nationwide with them.
Watch for one in your area. If you'd like more of Kevin Lehman's insight, get his latest book. It's called Planet Middle School, full of rich information for you parents, grandparents. It's available nationwide. Always great to have you here. Thank you so much, Terry.
Appreciate it. Mm-hmm.
We'll be back. Coming up, middle schoolers themselves are going to tell us some of their biggest problems from their perspective. Plus, we'll roll out the red carpet for a unique premiere. Stay with us.
CBN's Superbook airs in more than 75 countries around the world. And it's also introducing the plan of salvation to a whole new generation of children right here in America.
In 2009, the CBN animated series Superbook was re-released with a new look and fresh new storylines. And Gracie Smith was one of the first to see it. Her aunt, Audra Haney, is a producer for the 700 Club and was assigned to cover the premiere in Dallas, Texas.
I knew that my niece Gracie, who was four at the time, just had to be there to share that with me.
In the middle of the movie, I saw how brave he was. David was, and I learned to always be faithful and brave.
After the premiere, both Gracie and Audra were Superbook fans.
I was really impressed with the quality of the animation, but also just the integrity in which they were sharing these Bible stories.
But I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts.
Superbook takes them on fun adventures, and they take them in the past. Like the Battle of the Walls of Jericho, and they watched Jesus' miracles, walking on water.
Audra eventually joined the Superbook Club so she could keep sharing the Bible stories with Gracie.
Superbook Club is amazing for a couple of different reasons. First of all, I get a new updated Superbook every time they make one. But second of all, I get three copies. So not only have I been sending them to Gracie, but as our family has grown throughout the years, I've been able to send one to my younger brother's children, and I've also saved them for my own children.
She sends me Superbooks for Easter, birthdays, Christmas. She wants me to learn more about God.
One Sunday after church, her Sunday school teacher stopped me and asked me how she knew so much about the Bible. I have to give Superbook the credit. It's the Word of God. And it plants the Word of God into their hearts, and the Word of God never comes back void.
I think one of the most exciting Superbook moments for my family is when Gracie started to memorize the salvation poem, which is sung at the end of every DVD.
Jesus, you died upon a cross and rose again to save the lost.
And eventually she started asking me what it meant for Jesus to die and save us. And so it opened up a lot of conversation for us to talk about the plan of salvation.
On New Year's Day, 2013, Gracie gave her heart to Jesus and was later baptized.
I decided to follow him and be a disciple of his. I loved God very much and I wanted him to be my savior in my life.
I'm just amazed when I look at the fruit that I've seen in my entire family's life. And these cartoons that we're getting on a monthly basis, I know that they're having an eternal impact on my family. I'm just so grateful for that.
Well, Superbook is wonderful. As the father of three children under 10 years old, I can say I'm an enormous fan of Superbook. So is my entire family. My kids are thrilled when Superbook comes in the mail. I'm also a member of the Superbook Club. And when they come in the mail, my kids celebrate it, and they love to watch the episodes. They love learning about the Bible. They love singing the song at the end. And they initiate numerous conversations with me about the Bible. And sometimes I'll hear them talking in their rooms, and one will say to the other, well, remember what we learned in Superbook about this, and it applies to their life in their own little way. It's a wonderful, wonderful animation. I encourage you to join the Superbook Club, and so you'll be receiving new episodes as they come out. And to do that, you can call us at 888-777-1999 or go to our website and join the Superbook Club. Tara?
You know, Audra mentioned this in that piece, but one of the things I love about the club is that you do get three copies of it. So you've got one for your family and two to give away. And for those of us who are grandparents, what a great opportunity to be sure every family that has a grandchild in it has a copy.
And sometimes my children have decided who they would like to give the other episodes to. It's really wonderful
to see. It's a great gift, great gift. Well, coming up, from the homework to the bullies, students tell us why the hardest trials they face in school don't come in the classroom.
It's the Superbook Autumn Adventure. You'll receive this special bonus pack with this month's episode, Isaac and Rebecca. Join the Superbook DVD Club and get Superbook Isaac and Rebecca, plus two copies to share with others, all for your gift of only $25. And as part of our Superbook Autumn Adventure, receive three additional Superbook episodes featuring the most awe-inspiring stories from the Bible. DVD Club members, streaming for season one now available.
Life. It's meant to be lived fully. Jesus said it, I came to give you life. Life to the fullest. Life in your family. Life in your finances. Life in your body, mind, and spirit. Life in your everyday. At CBN.com, we're taking what Jesus said seriously. We're here to help you discover life. Life. Live it fully. CBN.com.
Well, between the pettiness, the temper tantrums, jealousy, and the occasional locker room wedgie, teens and preteens face trials the moment they walk through the halls.
Recently, we asked a few students and teachers about some of the issues they deal with and how they handle them.
Homework. Weird, tough age.
The tests are really difficult.
The homework.
You try to run without a teacher seeing you.
Friend issues.
Book reports.
I would say right now my biggest challenge is homework, because I'm doing really good in school, and then when I get home, it's like, oh no, I need to do this, and it takes me like forever.
My favorite thing about seventh grade is that you have a lot more responsibility and you're a lot more free, but at the same time, that's sort of a burden, because with that responsibility, you have to get your homework in on time.
There's a lot of independence given to them in the seventh and eighth grade, more so than in the lower grades. They're held more accountable for things.
So it is a very, very important time for them to feel like they can establish themselves who they are, and with definitely friends, because the friendships they are developing can last a long time, but they also got to learn who to establish their friendships with in their peer group.
Kids who get teased think they're afraid that nobody's gonna like hang out with them, and they want friends. So, and they're just trying to make friends. They are afraid that if they like say something back that the people that make fun of them won't like appreciate, then they won't make friends.
I think that if somebody jokes around, then it might tend to hurt other people, but they don't know it.
They're at this age where they just, you know, they want to be liked, they want people to like them, they're, you know, interested in having a boyfriend or having a girlfriend. So I think that the only way that at their age know how to work through that is by joking or making people laugh at them or making people want to be around them because they're just fun to be around.
I've never really felt put down by them. Like, if they do make fun of me, I'm just like, okay, that's what you think, I could care less. But I've seen it to happen to other kids, and I tell them, like, stop bothering them. You probably have the same issues that they do. So.
Somebody will get picked on, and usually I'll say something to the person picking on the person, because it's not right to do that.
When I get picked on, it's always hurting me, and the other people feel good, but it's hurting me.
I think a lot of times students don't know the boundary. They think they're just, you know, hanging out with their friends or joking around, but the people that's receiving it don't take it that way.
Just interacting with them, just letting them know that, you know, been there, done that, like, I know how you feel. This is not the end of the road. You're gonna keep on going. You're gonna keep on progressing. You're gonna figure out a lot more stuff about yourself, about the world, about school, you know, as they mature throughout the year.
Terry, I'm encouraged watching that. There's some kids out there with some real insight on what goes in their classroom.
Honestly, and the ability to express it. I mean, it's, you know, one of the things that makes you realize is how much kids begin to think, just process information and think, and how important it is, as Kevin Leman said earlier, that we listen. You know, that we find out, what are you thinking about? What's going on in your heart and mind? It really is a great age. There are certainly many challenges, but a great age and a great opportunity, I think, to establish a good, comfortable relationship so your kids feel like they can come home and be them.
And like you say, I mean, there's a Bible verse, of course, be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Sometimes when our children tell us things that happened at school, it can get us angry and frustrated.
Yes.
That can be our initial reaction, and we don't want to do that to them. You know?
Exactly, exactly. Love them well, keep the expectations reasonable.
And there should be no dumb questions for them. Let them express themselves, right?
Exactly.
The parenting is
try to remember that.
Yeah, it's difficult, but God can give us wisdom. We leave you with this verse. Now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace always, in every way. The Lord be with you all. For Terry Musin, I'm Andrew Knox. We'll see you next time on 700 Club Interactive.